you going to be standing by too?
No. Why?
Because you're the monster. What you said at the beginning of the show about Lena and me, I just got it, El Greeno.
Well.
Yeah, you meant that I couldn't follow her.
Well, Piggy, sometimes the truth hurts.
Hurt? I'll show you hurt.
You know, there's a children's TV show that I really enjoy. Maybe you've heard of Sesame Street. Anyway, here's one of my favorite songs from that show. Sing, sing a song. Sing out loud, sing out strong.
Sing of good things, not bad. Sing of happy thoughts and
sing, sing a song. Make it simple to last your whole life long. Don't worry that it's not good enough for anyone else to hear. Sing, sing a song. La 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 la.
You know that song. Sing, sing a song. Not only do the Muppets and Lena Horne tell us to sing a song, but did you know that God does too? You're probably thinking, well, where does he say that? I'm so glad you asked. Psalm 59, verses 16 and 17. That's Psalm 59. I know it says Proverbs. Pay no attention to that. Psalm 59, verses 16 and 17. Here's the song. The Bible says, but I will sing, David writes, but I will sing of your strength. In the morning I will sing of your love. For you are my fortress, my refuge in times of trouble. You are my strength. I sing praise to you. God, you are my fortress, my God, on whom I can rely. When tough times come, and they will, God says, sing a song. And when you sing a song, I would suggest to you that you would sing a song from David's set list. Here is song number one. Sing a song of strength. Sing a song of strength. If you will look there at the first part of the 16th verse in Psalm 59, you will see that David writes, but I will sing of your strength. When you are studying the Bible, when you are reading the Bible, context is king. Say that with me. Context is king. You need to understand what's happening in the verses around it and the chapters preceding and afterwards. You need to understand what's happening in the book. That way you just don't pull a verse out and make it say what you want it to say. That's called proper exegeting of the text, in case you're wondering, okay? Here's what I want to explain to you. When David makes this declaration and he says, but I will sing of your strength, here's what was going on at the time. The Bible tells us in Psalm 59 that King Saul had sent men to David's house to kill him. They were kind of waiting in the weeds. It's one thing when things are happening out there, but what happens when trouble comes home? Tough times, right? So what did David do? Did he blow a gasket? Did he run around going, oh, my, my, my. Did he go hide? No. The Bible says that he sang. And what I want you to understand is that when David sang, David sang. He didn't hum. He didn't whistle. He didn't lift up a lyric that was barely beneath an audible sound to the human hearing. The Bible says that he belted out a song of praise. Say, well, preacher, how do you know that? I'm going to take you to a place that will show you just that. Look, if you will, at Psalm 108, verses 1 through 5. Psalm 108, verses 1 through 5. Watch this. Here David writes, my heart, O God, is steadfast. What he's saying here is that everything that I am, everything that I have or ever will be, I am connected and committed to you, and I'm not going anyplace. God had said that to him, and he says that to you and me today. I'm connected to you, and I'm not going anyplace. He says, Lord, my heart is steadfast. It is committed to you. He says, I will sing and make music. What's it say with the rest of the verse there? With all my soul. If you allow me to teach for 2 seconds here. In Hebraic thinking, it's not so much that you have a soul, it's that you are a soul. It is the composite of your identity. Your thinking, your mind, your body, your physicality, and the Spirit of God that is within you. So here's when he says this. What's he say? He goes, I will sing and make music with all my soul. I'm going to do it with all my mind. I'm going to do it with all of my strength. I'm going to allow the Spirit of God to do it through me. I'm going to do it radically and all to the wall. Look at what he says. Awake, harp, and lyre. You know what that means? That means it's okay to praise God with whatever you got. Can I tell you that when I first came to Christ, I put away my guitars. I thought I was done with that chapter in my life. I thought, well, you know, they were good for a time, but that time is gone. I play them in places that we won't call church, okay? Don't look at me like that. Some of y'all used to hang out in those places. You know what I'm talking about. I came here to Crest Hill. I think I saw some of you in those places back then. I know some of y'all, right? We didn't look the same back then, though. That's all right. But the point I'm getting at is that I thought that chapter was done. And I went off to college, and I began to encounter some things, and I met some people. I met a guy named Larry Norman. Met a guy named Randy Stonehill. And I began to meet people. And I began to understand it was all right for me to pick up a guitar again. It was all right for me to start writing songs again. It was all right to be able to just praise God with what he had put in me. And so it may not be a guitar for you. It may be something else. Listen, you praise God with whatever you got. And accompany yourself if nobody else will. You know, sometimes we get in church and we're like, I can't sing, I can't hold, so, you know, I just don't even. And listen, don't worry about what somebody beside you says or does. You know, I'm reminded, Tony Evans tells a story about a fellow that was in church one Sunday, and he had a special need. He had a speech impediment. He couldn't speak well. And at the end of the service, the pastor called on him to offer the closing prayer. And he kind of, I hope I'm not being disrespectful, he kind of stuttered his way through it. And so at the end of it, there was one of the church mothers, you know what I'm talking about? One of the church mothers that was in the back of the church, and she was just going, and after the service, she comes up. It's amazing how there are some of us that believe it's our God-appointed duty to come and point out the faults in other folk. And she comes up to him and goes, that was just reprehensible. No one should pray like that. It was not dignified, and you should never pray like that. And he looked at her and said, ma'am, I wasn't talking to you. And so when you praise God, you praise him with whatever you've got. Can I tell you how much of a redneck I am? I love to cut my grass. Do you know why? I got an old Sears lawnmower that I bought used. It's got a Briggs & Stratton engine on it. You couldn't kill it with a gun. And when I'm out in my yard mowing my zoysia grass, I'd like to kill the guy that invented that stuff. It's like a weed, and it's like mowing over wires, and you mow your grass in 30 minutes, takes me 4 hours. I'm just telling you what. But I'm out there mowing my grass, and can I tell you, because it's so loud, I get to sing and praise God, and I don't care if anybody around me knows that I'm doing it, because I can't hear them. All I can hear is that engine. Roar, you know? So I'm praising God. I want to say to you, I believe that is why God made radios in your car a holy thing. So put it on the right station and rip off the knob. And then start singing praises to God. It doesn't matter if you're off tune. Did you know, I've been in a recording studio a couple of times. I've cut a couple, been with some bands and cut some CDs, you know, those, right? I've been a part of that. Can I tell you that they have this thing called auto-tune? We used to call it a pitchulator. If you're off pitch, they I believe that God has a built-in pitchulator, a built-in auto-tune, so that when you sing and you're going, amazing grace, it's going to amazing grace, God translates it, and it's beautiful. Touch your neighbor and say, I sing beautifully, you fool. So you praise him with whatever you've got. Sing. I have a banjo at home that was given to me. My family hates that thing. They do. I can only play it on the back porch. A little cold to be out there now. My dog likes it. My neighbors like it. I don't care. Praise him with that thing. Praise him with whatever you've got. Slap your neighbor and tell him, praise him. All right, now. Awake, harp and lyre, I will awaken the dawn. Watch this here. It says, I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. Listen, I was praying the other morning. Can I go here? I was praying the other morning, and one of the things that God showed me in my prayer time with him is that it's great when God is doing something in your life, but if you don't open up your mouth and tell somebody about it, you are missing a boat. If God is doing something in your life, don't keep it to yourself. Open your mouth. Lord knows we love to talk about everything. Let's talk about him. Let's brag on him. Let's talk about what he's done. Hey, how you doing there? What's going on in your life? Could you imagine if we just opened up and told people what God was doing in our lives? Remember what I said. What if just for 7 days this week, this upcoming week, we just radically, passionately love Jesus, and we allowed Jesus to radically, passionately love us? Could you imagine that? Listen, have you ever been with teenagers that are in love? Oh, heck, the teenagers. You ever been around anybody? I've been around 60-year-olds that have found love again. They got that look in their eye, you know, and you talk to them, and it doesn't matter what the subject matter is. It's like, it always comes back to that. Always comes back to the one that they're in love with, the one that loves them. Oh, let me tell you, what if we did that with Jesus? Didn't matter what we were talking about, we always steered the conversation back to that. Praise him. You know, it's getting real quiet in here, isn't it? That tells me the Holy Ghost is doing surgery. Let me press on here. It says, I will sing of you among the peoples, for great is your love. Higher than the heavens, your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory, remember, that's when God shows up and shows off. Let your glory be over all the earth. Isn't that what we're praying for? Isn't that what we ought to sing about? God, show up and show off all over the earth. I'm telling you, if we will pray and commit that to prayer, we're going to watch the news change. I don't know about you, but when I watch the news, it depresses me. Once in a while, they'll put in a positive story, but it ain't too often. But it depresses me. And I'm thinking, what if we started praying and then watched the news change? Oh, you know you have the power to do that, right? Touch your neighbor and say, I am not a wimp. Touch your neighbor and say, I can change the world. Through my song. Look at what he says here. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth. When David sang, he began by praising God for who God was. That's what we need to do. We praise God for who he is. We thank God for what he's done, what he's doing, what he says he's going to do. And we pray that. And when David was in a tough, tight place, God gave him strength. When the going got tough, I'm going to edit here on the fly. When the going got tough, David sang, and he sang of God's strength. Song number two in David's set list. Song number two in David's set list. Sing a song of love. Sing a song of love. Look there at the second part of the 16th verse. Here David writes, in the morning I will sing of your love. Now, why sing a song of God's love in the morning? How many of you are pleasant when you rise? How many of you could say that you would be, you know, the poster child for a good mood first thing in the day? There's the rub, as Bill Shakespeare would say. Truth be told, you know why an alarm clock has a snooze button on it? Because there are a lot of us that wish what came as standard equipment was a hammer. How many of us like the alarm clock? Listen, you know what I've learned? You know, if you set your cell phone, you're going to need to buy a new one because that sucker's going to be thrown up against the wall, I guarantee. We don't like having to wake up. How many of you just like, glory to God, I'm glad to be alive. Come on, let's just talk. Right? Do you know, and what I'm talking about here, this is, listen here, that is us in the natural. Because of Jesus, he wants us to put some super on the natural. So therefore, we are transformed as we're transfixed on him. Therefore, we enter into our day differently. What would happen if instead of going, oh, Lord, morning, we went, oh, Lord, morning. It's all about your attitude. Remember, I taught on this a couple of weeks ago. Your attitude, not your aptitude, determines your altitude. The way you look at life, not how smart you are or what your experiences are, nor how trained you are, determines how high and how far you go. And can I tell you, usually it's won in the battle of the blankets. The war is won in the battle of the blankets. If you can get out and come victorious in your battle of the blankets, and your feet hit the floor praising God, it will change your day. And I truly believe it may change somebody else's. In the morning, O Lord, you hear my voice. In the morning, I lay my request before you and wait in expectation. David began his day by giving his day to God. He began his day singing a song of praise to God. Listen, the things that come out of our mouths become realities. The things that come out of our mouths become realities. If you wake up in the morning and go, oh God, I'm so tired, I'm so tired. This is going to be a terrible day because I'm so tired. You're going to be tired all day long and you're going to have a terrible day. I hate my job. I hate my boss. I hate my commute. I hate everybody. And so, at the course of the day, you're going to hate your boss and hate your job and hate everybody. But if you change your song, you know what songs are, don't you? It is life set to music. So, you know, you need to sing a different song. Touch your neighbor and say, sing a different song. And so you need to sing a song of love, a song of praise, and it will change all of that. David sang because he knew that God loved him. Now, the Bible describes David as a man after his own heart. But here's what you got to understand. You might be sitting out there today and say, well, Pastor, it must be easy for you. You spend all your time in prayer and spend all your time in Bible study, spend all your time in worship, and everything in your life is so good. I would love to have you shadow me for a while. I'd like to welcome you into my world for a while. I'm going to let you in on a little secret. You think Satan comes after you? I'm responsible for you. Imagine what he does to me. You think your week is, think about mine. So the point I'm getting at is that this is not just somebody that is in full-time ministry, and this is not just for somebody that is in some elevated, you know, cloister that is, you know, pulled back. Say, I could just do this if I could be like one of those monks, you know, where I could just get away from it all. No, that's not the way that God intended to be. This is for all of us, and none of us are disqualified. David, you will never find David wearing an award that says Father of the Year. David was one of the worst fathers that ever walked the planet. You will never find David getting a Father's Day card, or no, an anniversary card from one of his, I don't know how many wives the guy had. None of it turned out well. Right? He was a murderer. Do you remember that story? Oh, he was an adulterer before that. But the thing is, the Bible also says that David was a man after God's own heart. He had a heart for God. He had a heart for God. So listen, when he messed up, he repented. Listen, no matter what you do, no matter how badly it turns out, if you will come to God and turn away from your sin and turn away from yourself, God will always receive you. Now, that doesn't mean that that's an excuse for you to screw up. Let's make that speak. That doesn't mean I'm just going to do what I want to do and I'm just going to come all back. You know, I was sinking deep in sin. Whee! No. I feel the Holy Ghost up in here. No. You don't do that. You go in with an attitude of, I'm going to serve you and follow you. What did we talk about earlier? I'm going to love God and be loved by God. But when you mess up, come back to God. Touch your neighbor and say, when I mess up, I come back to God. David tells us in Psalm 101, verse 1, I will sing of your love and justice. To you, O Lord, I will sing praise. In 1998, in their album Cutting Edge, the band Delirious released a song that spoke of what David sang about, the love of God. Here's their song.
Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. Sing your love forever. Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. Yeah, I can sing of your love forever. feel like dancing. It's foolishness, I know. But when the world has seen the light, they will dance with joy like we're dancing now, yeah.
They will sing a song, and let your song be a song of love. When tough times come, don't give up, don't give out, don't give in. Do what David did, sing a song of strength. Do what David did, sing a song of love. Next week, we will listen to songs 3 and 4 in David's set list, but until then, lift up your head. Until then, lift up your heart. Until then, lift up your voice and sing a song. Let's stand.